Swamin Namaste Nataloka Bandho Karunya Sindho Patitam Bhavabdho Mamudharatmiya Kataksha Drishtya Rijvyati Karunya Sudhabhivrishtya Swamin Namaste Swamin Namaste Swamin Namaste Swamin Namaste Yat Kirtanam Yat Smaranam Yadikshanam Yad Vandanam Yat Shravanam Yad Arhanam Lokasya Sadyo Vidhunoti Kalmasham Tasmai Subhadra Shravase Namo Namaha Vichakshanaya Charanopasadanat Sangam Vyudasyo Bhayatontaratmanaha Vindantihi Brahmagatim Gataklamaha Tasmai Subhadra Shravase Namo Namaha Tasmai Subhadra Shravase Namo Namaha Tasmai Subhadra Shravase Namo Namaha Jai Guru, Jai Guru, Jai Guru. I first prostrate at the holy lotus feet of my Guru and seek his blessings so that I am able to speak about Sri Krishna very well, bringing him in front of our eyes. I then prostrate at the feet of Lord Sri Krishna himself, who is none but my Guru manifested, and seek his blessings so that I can talk about him and be filled with delight myself, and I can radiate delight everywhere. Then I prostrate at the feet of all of you devotees who have come and assembled here, have been coming day after day from morning till night and listening with great devotion, hearing the excellences of the Lord, singing his name, dancing with joy, and making this place a real Vaikuntha. I prostrate at the whole universe, who is nothing but the Lord, the Lord's creation. Jai Guru, Jai Guru, Jai Guru. Some time back in our ashram, when I was taking some classes, the regular classes that we have there, I started reading this portion, Akrura Goes to Vrindavan. While reading, I felt it was so very sweet, this narration and this incident, the episode, that when this time it was decided, I was being asked what should be my topic, I felt I can talk on this. I won't say that it is a talk. I would like to share with you that whatever I felt while going through this episode. I think all of you by this time is eager to hear more and more about Lord Krishna. As Parikshit was, he had taken to Prayopavesha because on the seventh day he was to be bitten by a snake and death would come to him. So he had taken to Prayopavesha, and when Shukamuni and others came there, he told Shukamuni, please tell me, why, what I should do, what I should chant, what I should remember, what I should worship. And tell me also what I should not do. For a man whose death is imminent, what is his duty, please tell me. And Shukadeva started talking to him. He went on listening, listening and listening, but with as the days passed, he was becoming more and more eager to hear about Krishna. So he told Shukadeva that you have told me about the Surya Vamsha kings, the Chandra Vamsha kings, and the kings of the Yadava dynasty. All you have told me. Now please tell me about Krishna. Why did he take birth? Why he was taken to Nanda Gopa's house by his father Vasudeva? And please also describe to us all his excellences, all his sports, all the activities that he did. He told Sukadeva that I am sitting and listening to you with so much of yearning. I have not taken food or drink, not a single drop of water I have taken for last 3 days, 4 days. And I have not taken a single particle of food even. But, O Lord, O Maharshi, because you are talking about Sri Krishna, which is a amrita, a kathamrita, and I am drinking that kathamrita, I don't feel any hunger or thirst. I feel I can hear and hear for ages. So please tell me what Krishna did and why he was born and what happened to him. You all know the story of Krishna's birth, how when Krishna was born as the 8th child, Vasudeva took him to Nandagopa, because the Lord himself who took birth, the birthless Lord who has no birth, took birth in a human form in Devaki's womb. And the day when he was born like a deva, a little child with 4 hands and looking like Lord Vishnu. The Lord himself told his father Vasudeva, take me to Nandagopa's house. There one girl is born to Yashoda. Bring her here and let this child be kept there. By Yoga Maya's effect, nobody was awake. Everybody slept, including the guards and everybody in that kingdom. And Vasudeva took that child, small little Krishna, went to Nandagopa's palace, kept him by the side of Yashoda and brought back the daughter which was born to Yashoda. Nobody came to know. And when the girl was brought back, then after everything was over, the girl started crying, the baby started crying. Then Kamsa came, and to kill that 8th child about whom Kamsa was waiting with fear, thinking that this child will be killing me. And in that process he had killed 7 children of Devaki, and this one also he took and threw it on the stone. But so much of wonder, that child flew to the sky. It was not a boy even, it was a girl, and it was with his 10 hands. It said, foolish king, I am not the one who is going to kill you. Whoever is going to kill you has already got born. So Kamsa was absolutely wonderstruck. He also was repentant that he killed the innocent children of his sister, all the other children. But Kamsa's ministers and emissaries, they all came and told, oh, this is what that child, the 8th child has told. So we will go and kill all the children. Also we will kill the holy people in this country. Kamsa said, okay. So all the asuras went here and there, started killing the children. Meanwhile, Krishna was found in Nandagopa's house. And when the got up in the morning, Nandagopa and Yashoda, they felt that Krishna was the child who was born. So there was festivity. And after a long time, a son was born to Nandagopa. So everybody was very, very delighted. There was a lot of festivity. Then naming ceremony was there. Gargacharya came and named him Krishna and said, this child will be equal to the prowess and strength of Lord Narayana himself. So look after him well. He will do all the good for your clan. The seventh child which was to be born in Devaki's womb, that seventh child was withdrawn and put in the fetus womb of Rohini, Vasudeva's another wife, by Yogamaya himself. And that child was born to Rohini before Krishna was born. His name was Balarama. So Balarama and Sri Krishna both started growing. Where was Rohini? Rohini was in Nandagopa's house. And why? Because Kamsa's men, they started torturing the good people. So in the country, many of them, the Bhojavamsa, Vrishnivamsa people, because of Kamsa's torture, they started fleeing from Mathura. Similarly, this Rohini, another wife of Vasudeva, also went in hiding. And because Nandagopa was Vasudeva's friend, Nandagopa gave her shelter at that time. So Balarama and Krishna both started growing in Nandagopa's house. All this story you know. Now what happened? There was lot of joy and delight in Vrindavan because of this child and Balarama. The cowherd boys, they used to go and graze the cattle. Krishna will be playing the flute, and right from his birth, asuras came and tried to kill him. Nobody knew. They did not know that Krishna is the one who is going to kill Kamsa. But asuras, as they had thought that they will go and kill the children, so they started killing the children. And all the asuras who had tried that got killed themselves. The elders and Nandagopa himself in Gokula, they used to think, how is it possible? How is this small child surviving? He should have got killed. But it is very strange that all these asuras are getting killed themselves. Sometimes Nandagopa would remember that Gargacharya had told that this boy is equal to Narayana himself. So everybody used to think in Gokula that Narayana himself is protecting this child. They all never understood that he was Narayana himself. Like this, days were passing, but Krishna has taken birth in a human form to relieve the earth of its burden. The asuras and the evil kings, they had become a burden to the earth. So Lord Vishnu himself had got incarnated as Krishna. So one day Narada thought, no more waiting. Now Krishna must do what he has come for. You know, Narada, he always goes and gives some mantrana, some advice. Sometimes it will look that he is giving wrong advices, but it was all for the good. He came to Kamsa and said, O king, you have remained very foolish. You know, the eighth child of Devaki was supposed to be a boy, but all of us found that it was a daughter, and we all believed it. It is not like that. That daughter was born to Yashoda and Krishna was born to Devaki. Vasudeva has switched the children. Now, I have told you this much. After that, whatever you want to do, you do. Saying this, Narada went away. Kamsa was furious with rage. He immediately took his sword and tried to kill Vasudeva. Vasudeva was very innocent. He had always suffered in the hands of Kamsa, he and his wife Devaki. Narada stopped Kamsa, saying that, why are you killing him? It is Krishna who will kill you. So Kamsa chained them up in the prison again. And then he called Chanura and Mushtika, two very great wrestlers, and told them, "See, I have come to know that Krishna and Balarama, they are going to kill me. So you arrange for a wrestling match, Malla Yuddha, and put galleries in the amphitheater and the stadium. Call all the people of the country, let them see. And keep the Kubalaya Pida, elephant who is like death itself, at the gate. So when these boys come, the elephant should be killing them. If he escapes, let him come to the wrestling ground, and you both should kill them. I am very sure that these two boys will be defeated by both of you." Saying that, he gave these orders and he went to Akrura. Who is this Akrura? Akrura also belonged to the Yadava dynasty, and he was staying in Mathura. When many of these Yadavas, Bhojas and Vrishni Vamsha people, they all left Mathura because of the evil rule of Kamsa, torture of Kamsa and his men. Some of the men did not go. They waited there thinking with lot of reliance on God that someday good day will come to this country. Akrura was one of them. He was a very noble soul. He was a great Vishnu Bhakta. But since he remained in Mathura, he was serving Kamsa as a minister. So Kamsa went to Akrura, took his hand in his hand and pleadingly said, "I have lot of faith in you. You are my closest friend. You are very humble and you are truthful. So please, you do one favor for me. You go to Gokula and bring Balarama and Shri Krishna here. Here is a beautiful chariot which you should drive and go." Then he told why he was wanting them to come. Told everything, said they are the ones Narada Maharshi has told me just now. They are the ones who are going to kill me. So please bring them. I will get them killed here. Because I cannot go there and kill them. So let us bring them here. Don't tell, go and tell the plan. Go and tell them that I want to see them. I have heard about their prowess and strength. So I would like to see them, and I have arranged for a match so that they can show their might in that match. Also tell them that I am having a Dhanur Yajna being done, that is bow worship, Dhanur Yajna, in which wrestling match will be a part. In that Dhanur Yajna, all people will be invited. So along with Balarama and Shri Krishna, invite all people of Vraja, the Gokula, and ask them to come with carts full of milk and milk products. When they come, first I will kill Balarama and Krishna, then I will kill all his people. They will be so sad seeing Balarama and Krishna dead that they will not be able to protect themselves. And after that, I will kill my own father and then sit on the Simhasana with nobody as my enemy. And for this, who will help me? My father-in-law Jarasandha will help me. My father-in-law Jarasandha is very mighty and valorous. He is going to help me. And I have got some friends, of which Dvividha is one and so many others. Akrura heard everything and he said, "Okay, O king, I will do whatever you are asking me to do. I will go. But I can tell you this much. To protect yourself from death in the hands of these two children, whatever you are planning is okay. But you must be even-minded. In anything, any plan, siddhi and asiddhi can come. You have to take note of divine will. If divine will is there, you may succeed. If divine will is not there, you will not succeed. So please keep this in mind." Saying this, he went home, and next day he started towards Vrindavana. When he is going, he started thinking, "You know, I would like you to imagine, where are we? We are sitting in this Naimisharanya. But our imagination should go there. where Parikshit is sitting in front of Shukadeva, surrounded by many, many pandits and brahmins and scholars and celestial beings, all the country people. He is sitting with one pointed attention because his death is imminent. Few days are left. He is sitting with hands folded and tears flowing down his cheeks, telling Shukadeva, please tell me more and more and more, so that I can get merged in the thought of the Lord. All this while my mind was in all worldliness. I used to think I was a devotee, but I was not a devotee. If I was a devotee, how could I be angry and how could I have insulted one Brahmin, which I should not have done? So now I want to take my mind away from everything else and I want to think of the Lord to the exclusion of everything in this world. Saying this, he was listening. And what was Shukadeva doing? Shukadeva was telling him stories and stories and stories of devotees. And the Lord, description of the Lord, his deeds, his exploits, his excellences. And hearing and hearing and hearing, all that was filling the heart and mind of Parikshit. We should be there now, where Shukadeva is telling this story of Akrura. Now what is Akrura? He is a Vishnu Bhakta. He is going to Vrindavana to bring Shri Krishna and Balarama, and he knows that Kamsa is going to kill them, but he is not afraid. He is so much faith and reliance on the Lord. He knows Krishna has taken incarnation and Kamsa will be killed by Krishna. Kamsa will not be able to kill Shri Krishna. He will be killed himself. So that fear was not there. Instead, he was filled with a wonder. He was feeling that I am a Vishnu Bhakta. I am Shri Krishna Bhakta. I have been hearing about this boy who has taken birth and is growing in Nandagopa's palace. I was hearing about his beauty, his gait, his excellences, what he was doing, how he has robbed the hearts and minds of all the Gopa and Gopikas. And I was really wanting and desiring to see him. Now, Kamsa is sending me with an evil objective, but my wish will be fulfilled now. I will be able to see him. I will be able to touch his feet. I will be able to see him and maybe I will say some stutis also. Dear devotees, we have to get identified with the characters. Then only we can realize. We have to experience. I am here telling you a story. The Bhagavata has all these things printed in the books that are available. We can read them every day. I can tell this story again and again and again. But unless we experience this, unless we become the Akrura and feel that I am going to Vrindavana, I am going to see Krishna, I am going to bring him, I am going to fall at his feet, and what will happen to me, how I will feel at that time, if we are not able to imagine and identify, we will not be able to have that divine feeling, the devotion that Akrura had. So Akrura is saying, he's telling, Kim maya charitam bhadram, kim taptam paramam tapaha, kim vathapyarhate dattam, yadrakshyam yadya keshavam, mamaitad durlabham manye, uttamashloka darshanam, vishayatmano yatha brahma kirtanam, shudra janmanaha, maivam mamadhamasyapi, Syadevachyuta darshanam, hiyamanah kala nadya, vachittarati kashchana. He is going in that beautiful chariot and he is saying, thinking to himself, what have I done? What good work have I done? What tapasya I have done? What great dana I have given? That today I am having this opportunity, a great opportunity to go to Vrindavan and see the Lord. See the Lord in his actual form. I don't think I have done anything good. But how is it that I am being sent there? It is as difficult for Vedas to be uttered by the low caste people. Similarly, the vision of God, the vision of Sri Krishna is difficult for people who have worldliness in their mind. Who is attracted to the world, the worldliness, they will not have the vision of God. But how is it that I, who is also having worldliness in my mind, I am feeling, I am going today, slowly proceeding towards Vrindavan. And how is it that I will be seeing him today? So, then he says, Mamadya mangalam nashtam phalavam shaivame bhavaha yannamasse bhagavato yogidhyayanghri pankajam. When I see him today, I will see him today itself. And when I see him, whatever sin I have done, all will get destroyed. I will do pranam to him, pranam to his holy lotus feet. And what are those holy lotus feet which the yogis for years and years, ages and ages, they are meditating upon? They are not attaining him. But I, whom I myself feel is a simple, normal, ordinary person, I am going to see him today and fall at his feet. Oh, how blessed I am. How fortunate I am. Kamsovatadya kritametyanugraham drakshengri padmam prahito munahare kritavatarasya duratyayam tamaha purvetaran yannakamandalatvisha. It is because of Kamsa. Kamsa, who has no generosity, who is always cruel and unkind. Such a Kamsa has become instrumental for sending me to Vrindavan. If it was not for Kamsa, I would not have come. So, I am very, very grateful to Kamsa. He is sending to Vrindavan and I will be seeing the holy lotus feet of the Lord and do pranam. Those feet, the light of the toenails of which the feet, the toenails, you know, the big toenails, the light which comes out from those toenails, those take away the darkness of ignorance from all the devotees' mind. All great men who have been worshipping God, who have been doing sadhana for years and years, from their mind the darkness of ignorance goes away when they do pranam at holy lotus feet of the Lord. Yadarchitam brahma bhavadhi visuraihi shriyaja devya munibhissa sattvataihi gocharanayanucharaischaradvane yad gopikanam kuchakunkumankitam. He says, these feet are worshipped by Brahma, Maheshwara, all the devas, all the munis, all the devotees, Sri Lakshmi herself, they are worshipping these feet. Which feet are now, when he has got born in this world as Sri Krishna, is roaming about in the forests of Vrindavan, and along with him are his friends, the gopas, the cowherd boys, and the cows and the calves. They are all going and roaming about in the Vrindavan. His beautiful feet, which has become human now, all the people, the devotees, and the gods and goddesses, they have been worshipping him. And he thinks about the Vrindavana, what he has heard of. Beautiful forest where every day, every morning Krishna goes wearing his dress, his vanamala, having a flute in his hand, Balarama accompanying him and his friends accompanying him. With the cows and the calves, they go to various places in Vrindavan wherever grass is and cows can graze well. So when they go, that in that Vrindavan, There are lots of beetle bees who sing, hum, as if they are the yogis who are singing stutis for Lord Krishna. The peacocks dance. The beautiful lake is full of lotuses. The lotus fragrance is everywhere in that place. And when they pass trees and creepers, what happens? All the trees and creepers bow down as if the flowers that they are bearing, they want to offer at the feet of the Lord. And the fruits that they are bearing, they are offered for Lord Krishna. Like this, Akrura was thinking, this Lord whom I am going to see, he is roaming about in Vrindavana now. And Vrindavan is like this place. O devotees, I'll remind you again and again and again. Let not your thought go anywhere else except the Vrindavan where we are going. We are also going with Akrura to that Vrindavan, which he is now thinking in his mind. This Vrindavan is like this, like that. I've heard about him like this. He looks like this and he looks like that. The beautiful Lord. He is going to see him. Can you imagine with what yearning, what anxiety, what feeling he is going there to meet his beloved Lord? All of us should have that feeling in mind now. Drakshyaminunam sukapolanasikam smitavalokarunakanjalochanam mukham mukundasya gudalakavritam pradakshinam me pracharanti vai mrigaha. Drakshyaminunam sukapolanasikam. He says, it's very shortly I will be seeing him. I'm only thinking of doing pranam, but I will be seeing him also. Just now I have understood, it's not that I'll be doing pranam only. I'll see him. That beautiful face, which has a very broad forehead, beautiful cheeks, beautiful nose, and a lock of hair is covering his forehead. He is wearing vanamala and a pitambara. He is looking so beautiful with his flute which he is playing. I will be seeing. And I am very sure that I will see, because I am seeing some very good signs. Some deers are roaming around me. And because the deers are roaming, it must be very auspicious. What is going to be auspicious for me? That I am going to see him today. Apyadya Vishnor Manujatvamiyusho Bharavataraya Bhuvo Nijetshaya Lavanya Dhamno Bhavito Palambhanam Mahyam Nanasyat Palamanjasadrishaha. Apyadya Vishnor Manujatvamiyusho Bharavataraya Bhuvo Nijetshaya Lavanya Dhamno Bhavito Palambhanam Mahyam Nanasyat Palamanjasadrishaha. Very soon now, I am going to see that Vishnu who is Lavanya Dham. Lavanya Dhamma. He is the most beautiful object in this world. I am going to see him. And who has come down to this earth with his own will, Nijetchaya. He has taken birth in this world for the good of the world. I am going to see that Vishnu very soon. I am just proceeding towards that place. When I see him, you know, he is becoming anxious. When I see him, will not my eyes attain that state where I will not need to see anything else? I will be so fulfilled with that one darshan that now I want to see this, I want to acquire this. This is a common man. Common man's mind is like that. He wants to acquire this, he wants to see many variety of things. I am also like that, Akrura is thinking. But will I not get that state after seeing him? when my mind and my eyes will get fulfilled and will not want to see anything else. It will be so filled with the darshan that it will be absorbed in the Lord Himself. Yasya khilami bahabhissu mangalaihi vacho vimishra gunakarma janmabhihi pranante shumbhanti punanti vai jagat yastad viraktah shavashobhanamatah yasya khilami bahabhissu mangalaihi. The words and the compositions which are devoted to describe this holy Lord, they are all very sanctifying, purifying, and they are His excellences, these auspicious excellences of His, and His sportive activities. All these are, when somebody reads them, hears them, it purifies the whole world. The words which have been written about Him, the songs which have been sung about Him, the compositions which are for Him, they purify the world, they energize the world, and they beautify the whole world. And the compositions which do not have these His words, expressions about Him, descriptions about Him, those are absolutely useless. He is thinking. You know, at some other place, Bhagavata says, Mrishagirasta hyasati rasat katha na kathyate yad bhagavan adhokshajah tadeva satyam taduhaiva mangalam tadeva punnam bhagavad gunodayam tadeva ramyam ruchiram navam navam tadeva shashvan manaso mahotsavam tadeva shokarnava shoshanam rinam yaduttama shloka yashonugiyate. So at other places Bhagavata is saying, Mrishagirasta hyasatirat satkatha, as Akrura is saying, that anything which describes Him is energizing, beautifying, purifying. And any composition where His name is not there, His description is not there, is absolutely unreal and useless for men. So this shloka is saying, Mrishagirasta hyasati rasat katha na kathyate yad bhagavan adhokshajah tadeva satyam taduhaiva mangalam. That alone is truth. That alone is auspicious, which describes Him, which talks about Him, which tells about His excellences. Tadeva ramyam ruchiram navam navam. Not only that, it is satya and mangala. It is ruchiram and navam navam, ramyam. It is beautiful and it is tasty. It is new and new every day. Whatever we get in this world, anything we want, and we suppose we get it, it becomes old after a few days. The newness goes. But His descriptions, the stutis that we make about Him, His sports, His excellences, His songs, everything has beauty in it. Everything has newness every day. Not only that, tadeva shokarnava shoshanam rinam. It takes away all the misery and sorrow which people have. In this world, everybody is scorched by worldliness, worldly sorrows. Nobody is there who has only sukha. Sukha and dukkha come together. And if we really estimate and analyze, we will find sukha is less and dukkha is more. We want things, we find sukha when we have it. But immediately the fear of losing it comes. Fear of protecting it comes. So we cannot have sukha always. It is always mixed with dukkha. And only what is beautiful, what is blissful always, unbroken bliss and unbroken delight is only in His name. That is what this shloka is saying. And Akrura is saying the same thing, that whatever describes the Lord, it energizes, beautifies, purifies. And if there are compositions where God's name is not there, His exploits are not there, they are useless for mankind. Tam tadvadyanunam mahatagatim gurum trailokya kantam drishiman mahotsavam rupam dadhanam shriyaipsitaspadam drakshe mamasannushasar sudarshanah tam tvadyanunam mahatam gatim gurum trailokya kantam drishiman mahotsavam. Do you understand the meaning of the words? The beautiful words that Bhagavatam is writing, Vyasadeva has written. And who is saying? Shukadeva is saying to Parikshit. Shukadeva is telling the story of Akrura, and Akrura is saying this. Drishiman Mahotsavam. He is saying, I am going to see that Lord, Trailokya Kanta. He is the most beautiful in this world. And for those who have eyes, He is the worthiest person to be seen. My dear devotees, do we see Him? We are happy to see our children, our grandchildren, our car, our gadgets, new mobile, everything, jewelry. We are happy to get promotions, recognition, prestige and what not. Do we look for Him? We don't look for Him at all. But Bhagavatam is saying, Drishiman Mahotsavam. If you look at Him, that will give you the Shashwat, eternal festivity. Everybody wants festivity. See, this is a festivity. This Satrashala is a festive place. Everybody is coming here. Everybody's mind from morning is towards this place because it wants festivity. But have you thought, this festivity is going to get over one day, on 1st January, after the Vishnu Sahasranama is over. And when you go back to your houses, the festivity will not be there. Maybe for few days, you will still be remembering these festive days. But after some time, it will simply fade away. So is there anything which is eternal festivity? Bhagavatam is saying, this thinking about the Lord, chanting His name, singing His glory, and keeping Him in the heart, that is the eternal festivity. Oh devotees, why don't we think like that? Why don't we, even if we have read 100 and 1,000 times, we are not doing anything to keep Him in our heart always and having a Shashwata Mahotsavam, which will never die, never fade? Are we not to do it? Are we, year after year, year after year, we are hearing the Bhagavatam, reading the Bhagavatam and Saptaham, but are we making an effort to be in that state, to reach that state which Akrura had reached, to reach that state which Parikshit had? He says, I am going to see the Trailokya Kanta, and He is the worthiest person in this world to be seen for those who have eyes. And we all have eyes. We are not making any effort to see Him. Darshaniyatamam shantam mano nayana vardhanam. He is the darshaniyatamam. If something has to be seen, He has to be seen. The inner Lord has to be seen. For that, you don't have to go anywhere, devotees. He is just inside us. Very near, very dear. He is stretching His arms for us. He wants us to just look at Him. And He is always smiling. But we do not want to see inside. We are always seeing outside. To the perishable world, the world that will not remain, the perishable objects are alluring us and we look for that. We do not look at the imperishable self, the Bhagavan, Ishvara, who is inside us, in our heart itself. He says, He is the refuge and master and teacher of the Mahat people, the Sajjanas, the devotees, those who worship Him. For Him, He is the refuge and He is the teacher. And He is the aspiration of Sri Lakshmi Devi. Lakshmi Devi is also always wanting to attain Him. So today, I will be seeing Him, that Trailokyanatha, who is Drishiman Mahotsavam. And I think I'll definitely see Him, because since morning, so many auspicious things are happening to me. Athavarudh sapadishayorathat pradhanapumsos charanam swalabdhaye dhyadhritam yogivirapyaham dhruvam namasya abhyam cha sakhin vanaukasah athavarudh sapadishayorathat. When I see Him, Akrura is saying, when I see Him, I will get down from the chariot and I will fall flat at His feet and I will do pranam to Him. That was those feet which the yogis, through their buddhi, they are trying to attain. I will fall at those feet and touch that feet, and I will also do pranam to all His friends and the comrades who are accompanying Him. Apyangrimule patitasya me vibhu shirasya dhasyan nijahasta pankajam dattabhayam kalabhujangaram hasa prodvejitanam sharanai shrinam rinam. Apyangrimule patitasya me vibhu shirasya dhasyan nijahasta pankajam dattabhayam kalabhujangaram hasa prodvejitanam sharanai shrinam nirnam. Each word has to be understood. Each word has to be contemplated upon. Each word has to be assimilated. Then only we will have that feeling, that bhava, that made Akrura be united with the God. What does He say? He is saying, Apyangrimule patitasya me vibhu. When I have fallen flat at His feet in Sashtanga Namaskara, what will that all-pervading Lord who has taken a human form do? He will keep His hands which are just like red lotus on my head. Devotees, when I read this, every time that I read, I feel I have that feeling which Akrura had. Can you think of those hands which is giving abhaya to people? Tears fill my eyes just like Akrura's did. He who is always there to relieve us from fear, we do not look at Him. Now the Lord, when Akrura has fallen at His feet, the Lord with His hand, He is giving Him abhaya by placing the two hands on His head, saying that don't be fearful. I am there. There is no fear. I will show you the way. I will lift you up. Please hold my hand. This is what the Lord is saying. Akrura says, these hands are the ones which take away fear from everybody. Everybody who is fearful in this world, and everybody is. This is, there is fear and fear in this world. Everybody has fear, tension and anxiety. With that, they are fearful of death. Death is following everybody with the speed with which the death follows. Nobody knows how to get rid of that fear. So whoever takes refuge in those holy lotus feet, he lifts them up. He says, I am there to relieve you from mortality. I will give you immortality. I will take you away and make you transcend what is fear. In this world, everywhere there is fear. Bhoge roga bhayam, kule chuti bhayam, vitte nripalad bhayam, mane dainya bhayam, vale ripu bhayam, rupe jaraya bhayam, shastre vadi bhayam, gude khala bhayam, kaye kritantad bhayam, sarvam vastu bhayanvitam bhuvinidam vairagyameva bhayam. Bhoge roga bhayam. Why people should take refuge at his feet? This shloka I say, bhoge roga bhayam. You may have enough wealth, but you will be haunted by the fear. Suppose you have disease. Suppose somebody else, your near and dear one, has some terminal disease. Will you be able to enjoy the wealth and the comforts that you have acquired and possessed? Kule chuti bhayam. If you are in a good vamsha, your lineage is very good, there is always a fear that somebody or other in your lineage will tarnish the name of your family. Vitte nipalad bhayam. If you have wealth, then you are always afraid of thieves and dacoits, and earlier days kings, and nowadays income tax. So you will be always fearful how to protect the wealth from getting robbed and thieved. Mane dainya bhayam, bane ripu bhayam, rupe jaraya bhayam. You may be having lot of name and fame, but there is always a fear that somebody will vilify your name. And bale ripu bhayam, if you are strong, always there is a fear of getting defeated by another stronger person. Rupe jaraya bhayam. When you are young and youthfulness is there, you are beautiful, then what is the fear? Fear of getting old. Shastre vadi bhayam. If you are a scholarly person, then you will be afraid of anybody who can defeat you in tarka. Gune khala bhayam. If you have lot of qualities, then also there is a fear that somebody will be behind you wanting to tarnish your name or vilify you. And at last is the fear of death. Kaye kritantad bhayam. So where is abhaya here? This whole world, everything is filled with and enveloped with fear and fear. So that is why those very rare few who can rely on God, who feel that if I hold the holy lotus feet of the Lord, He will lift me up from this fear and He will give me the abode of fearlessness. Only He can give the abode of fearlessness. No perishable object in this world can give it. So Atura is saying that Datta Bhayam, His hands He will keep on my head and I will be rid of all fear.
Namayupeshyatyari buddhimachyutaha kamsasya dutah prahitopi vishwadhrik yontarubahischetasa etadehitam shetrajya ikshatyamalena chakshusha.
He was thinking then, I am going with a very evil objective. I am going to bring him to Mathura so that Kamsa can kill him. Kamsa has given me this order. But he will not consider me an enemy, because he being the Sarvadrashta, he knows an inside and outside of everybody. He will understand that I am not going to him with any inimical feeling. I am not his enemy. I am a bhakta of his and I want to have his darshan. I have taken this opportunity only to see him. And then he will consider me as his friend.
Suhrittamam jyatim ananya daivatam daurbhyam brihadbhyam parirapsyate thamam atma hitirthikriyate tadaivame bandhascha karmatmaka uchvasityataha.
Suhrittamam jyatim ananya daivatam daurbhyam brihadbhyam parirapsyate thamam. He will consider me not as an enemy. He'll consider me as a great devotee and his close friend. And so, what he will do is, with his long arms, he will embrace me. He'll give me an embrace. And by his embrace, my whole being will become purified. Atma hi tirthi kriyate. And all my bondages, which I have acquired by doing karma in this world, all those will get dissolved. My whole being will become purified. He says this. Parirapsyatetha. When he gives me an embrace, then he says, Labdhanga sangam pranatam kritanjalim mam vakshyate kruratatetyurushravah tadavayam janma bhrito mahiyasa naivadrito yodhigamashya janmatat. Labdhanga sangam pranatam kritanjalim mam vakshyate kruratatetyurushravah tadavayam janma bhrito mahiyasa naivadrito yo dhigamushya janmatat. After having embraced me, when he will see that I was the one who had fallen at his feet, he has lifted me up and given me an embrace, and then he will call me Akrura. Oh Akrura, why have you come? He will call me like this with my name. And at that moment, my birth, the birth for which I have, the cause for which I have taken birth in this world, that will be fulfilled. I will be fulfilled to the core, and I will have nothing more to want from this world anymore. I will feel like crying out and asking people, calling out to everybody, please come. See how fortunate, how blessed I am. He has called me. He has called me by my name. He has given me embrace, and he has kept his hands on my head so that I am not fearful anymore. What is this pranam? We have been talking about Akrura going and touching his feet. Akrura is saying, I will see him. He looks like this, so beautiful. He is Trailokya Kanta. He is Lavanya Dhama. And he is describing the Lord. Then he says, I will get down from the Ratha. I will do pranam to him. He will put his hand on my head and give me an embrace and call me by name. What is this actually? It is a surrender to the Lord. Surrender and unburdening to the Lord without any motive, not wanting anything in return. We human beings, we are going to the Lord, to temples or wherever. We do puja, we do worship, always wanting something from him. Either wealth or house or children or some promotion, marriage of the daughter, job of the son. Always we are asking and asking and asking. But when a true devotee goes to the Lord, he does not ask anything. When we do pranam to the Lord, we should not ask anything. We should be absolutely motiveless. We should say, O Lord, I have come to you only because I love you. I cannot but live without you. I love you, O Lord. Then only we are devotees. We must analyze and assess our devotion. Are we devotees? If we are, from this moment onwards, we should not ask anything from him. So he says, those who have not got the touch of the Lord, those who have not heard his vani, those lives are absolutely useless, a crude I say. Like this, he kept on thinking and thinking and thinking. Then he enters Vrindavana. When he enters, it became nearly dusk. He had started in the morning, but maybe he was going slowly because he was completely absorbed in his reveries, what all he was thinking. He was completely actually immersed in the thought of the Lord. What do we understand? What do we learn from this episode of Akrura? If we read these slokas, it's only reading will not do. We have to ruminate. What is Bhagavata wanting to tell us from this episode? We should be like this. We should be constantly thinking of him. Akrura, when he started from Mathura to go to Vrindavana, till he reached there, his thought not for a moment had gone away from Krishna. He was constantly thinking of God. Are we like that? If we are not like that, are we going to make effort for that? If we are going to make effort, are we going to be sincere in our effort? Are we going to aim that we must have the thought of God always in our mind? Akrura's story is telling that, inspiring us to be thinking of the Lord always. So Akrura has reached Vrindavana. When he reaches Vrindavana, he is on what? The earth of Vrindavana, where the Lord every day goes grazing cows. He could see the footprints of the Lord, the footprints which had the signs of lotus, hook and grains. He could understand. Akrura immediately recognized, these are the footprints of my Lord. Oh, my Lord has been roaming here. So much punya is here in this dhuli. It is called Vraja Raja. In this dust, so much auspiciousness, holiness, purity is there. He became overwhelmed. Padani tasya khila loka kapa lokapala kirita jushta malapadareno dadarsha goshthe kshiti kautukani vilakshitanyabja yavankushadyaihi. So he saw the footprints where the marks of lotus, grain and hook was there. Taddarshanallada vivriddha sambrahamha sambrahamaha taddarshanallada vivriddha sambrahamaha premnordhvaromashru kalakulekshanaha rathadavaskandhyasa teshvacheshtata prabhuramunyangri rajamsyaho iti. He became overwhelmed. Ahlada. Seeing the footprints, he was filled with ahlada. That is overwhelmingness, excitement, full of devotion. And he started having horripilation all over the body. His eyes started shedding. And he immediately jumped out of the chariot and started rolling on that ground, saying, oh, this is my Lord's Padadhuli. This is my Lord's Padadhuli. And he became like that, completely immersed in the Lord. Dear devotees, from that time, when Kamsa had asked him to go to Gokula with the chariot to bring Sri Krishna and Balarama to Mathura, from that time, the way he has contemplated upon Sri Krishna, now it has got fulfillment where he got immersed in the Lord. Seeing the signs and emblems of the Lord, he simply lost himself. He got absorbed into himself. He got absorbed into the form of the Lord. This is the highest attainment a human being can have. This is what Bhagavata is telling us. This is the highest attainment. Not wealth, not bank balance, not few houses, not children, not friends, not relatives, not security, which you think security is. People think money is security, children is security, Houses are security. Position is security. No, that is not security. Security is the holy lotus feet of the Lord, where you completely rely on Him, completely rely on Him, and you feel He is the one to be attained in this life. I may have responsibilities. He has given me this birth. He has made all of you as householders and separate ashramites. He has given you various responsibilities and duties. You have to do everything. But know in your mind that this is not what the human life is for. Human life has some higher goal, higher aim, and that is to know that He is the supreme in our life, and He has to be attained. If this life has been given, doing all our responsibilities, performing all our duties, we must have time to realize Him, to attain Him, to know that He is my most dear, near one. He is the more secure refuge for me, nobody else. So, when He was in this condition, what happened, you know? He completely became self-effaced. His pride went, His fear went, His sorrow also went. He transcended all these things. He was a little proud that I am a minister in Mathura, in Kamsa's kingdom. He had some fear whether, being sent by Kamsa, Krishna will accept me. But now all his fear has gone, his pride has gone, all his sorrow has gone. Wow, how? When he got completely absorbed in the form of the Lord, whom he was seeing in his own heart, whose signs he was seeing in that Vrajadhuli. Then he looked further, and when he came down, he found Dadarsha Krishnam Ramam cha Vraje Godauhanam Gatau Pita Neelambaradharau Sharadamburuhekshanau. So he, just imagine, we should not forget the scene. Akrura, he has got down from the Ratha, he has rolled into the dust, feeling purified. And then when his eyes went further, he found that Rama, Balarama and Shri Krishna, they are standing there. Not only he saw the signs, now he is able to see them actually in actual human form. Pita Neelambaradharau Sharadamburuhekshanau. One was wearing a yellow dress, another one a blue dress. And one was fair, another was dark in color. Kishorau. I would like you to hear these lines very, very carefully. Please think, what is happening? Akrura is having a vision of Lord Krishna and Balarama. Here we are hearing these words which are describing the Lord Sri Krishna and His Amsha Balarama. So listen carefully. Through this listening, we should be able to see Him. As Akrura is saying, who is on the dust of Vrindavan. Kishorau Shyamala Shvetau Shriniketau Brihad Bhujau Sumukhau Sundaravarau Baladvirada Vikramau Dhvaja Vajrangshukam Bhojaihi Chinhitai Rangribhir Brajam Shobhayantau Mahatmanau Anukroshasmitekshanau Udara Ruchira Kridau Sragvinau Vanamalinau Punyagandhanu Liptangau Snatau Virajavasasau Pradhana Purushau Adyau Jagadhetu Jagatpati Avatirnau Jagatyarthe Swamshena Balakeshavau Avatirnau Jagatyarthe Swamshena Malakeshavahu. No words come after this. We have seen the Lord The two, Valarama and Shri Krishna, who were Kishora, young boys. They were, one was fair, one was dark. They had long arms, beautiful face, very beautiful and pleasant was the looks, and they had lot of prowess and might. They had these signals, signs and emblems, flag, thunderbolt, hook and lotus. They were going around the earth and the forest of Vraja, Vrindavana. They were adding to the splendor of Vrindavana. And they were looking here and there with smiling faces, spreading what? Only delight and peace, compassion and love. They had their krida, their sportfulness was enjoyable. They had small and big garlands on their neck. They had just taken bath and they were wearing very fresh, beautiful dresses, and sandal paste was smeared on their body. They are the Pradhana Purusha, the original being, the one imperishable, eternal Lord, who is beyond the cause and effect. But those are the Jagatpati, the master of the universe. They had come down as Jagat Hetu for the good of the world, Avatirno. They have come down from the heavens, Avatirno Jagatyarthe, for relieving the earth from burden. They have come down. Who have come down? Valarama and Shri Krishna. So when he saw them like that, he was overwhelmed. And earlier he was thinking that this will happen, I will do this, Lord will do this. Now actually that has come. Now actually he has seen Valarama and Shri Krishna. So he gets down from the ratha, gets down from the chariot, and with there is a surge of devotion. He is full of devotion in his heart, and he lies flat, does a sastanga pranam to the Lord Rama and Krishna. He was full with allada. His eyes were trickling, full of tears. Profuse tears were getting his cheeks wet. The cheeks were getting wet by the tears that he shed. And there was Roma Harshana. He was so much excited, so much overwhelmed, that he even forgot to tell them who he was and why he has come. But the Lord, who understands the devotee's heart, he took him up. First, Sri Krishna held his hand, lifted him up and held him in embrace. Then Balarama held his hand and took him inside and asked him why he will come. First they received him, welcomed him, made him sit on a very beautiful seat, washed his feet, because that is our culture, worshipped him with flowers, garlands and many things which he could use. They presented cows to him, and then slowly they asked, why you have come? How is everybody in Mathura? And why is it that you have come today? Akrura said, this is why I have come. Kamsa has planned like this. He has told that you should be taken there so that you won't know that he is having a plan to kill you. But this is his plan. There is a Dhanuryagna, and as a part, a wrestling match. So you must come with me in this Ratha. And all others, Gopas, are also invited. They should come with their carts full of milk and milk products. Hearing this, you know, Krishna and Balarama both laughed, because they know that hour has come for which Vasudeva and Devaki had undergone so much of torture and sorrow and pay in the hands of Kamsa. That hour has come when Kamsa will be killed by the hands of Shri Krishna and Balarama helping him. So they laughed. They said, okay, tomorrow we will go. And Krishna and Balarama told Nanda Gopa that tomorrow we will be going to see the Dhanuryagya and the Malla Yuddha. Also, all of you are invited so that you can see that great festivity which Mathura is going to have in the name of Dhanuryaga. So all of us, let us go. So this is the end of Akrura story. I think we must introspect, we must ruminate, we must reflect upon what we have heard and listened, what we have read, what is the actual bhava of Akrura, how he went, how he met, what was his darshan. And we should only focus on that one pointed devotion that he was having on Lord Krishna, so that at the end of it, he was absorbed in the Lord. You know, when the Lord gives an embrace, then all Ashubha, they got destroyed. Then this cycle of birth and death gets destroyed. And one enjoys the Brahma Nirvana Sukha. That is why Bhagavata tells again and again, Tato Bhajadvam Hridaye Hridishwaram. Adhokshajalambhamihashubhatmanah Sharirinah Samsriti Chakrashatanam Tad Brahma. Tad Brahma Nirvana Sukham Vidurbudhah Tato Bhajadvam Hridaye Hridishwaram Adhokshajalambhamihashubhatmanah Sharirinah Samsriti Chakrashatanam Tad Brahma Nirvana Sukham Vidurbudhah Tato Bhajadvam Hridaye Hridishwaram Tato Bhajadvam Hridaye Hridishwaram Tato Bhajadvam Hridaye Hridishwaram Jaya Shankha Gadadhara Neelakalevara Pita Patambara Dehi Padam Jaya Shankha Gadadhara Neelakalevara Pita Patambara Dehi Padam Jaya Bhakta Janashraya Mangala Karana Antima Mandhava Dehi Padam Jaya Bhakta Janashraya Mangala Karana Antima Mandhava Dehi Padam Jaya Shankha Gadadhara Neela Kalevara Pita Patambara Dehi Padam.